Okay, good morning again, everybody. Morning one more time. I have your attention one more time. Just to let you know, folks, that the washrooms are on the back on my right, and it will be on your left. You can get to it in two ways. Going right here through, but we prefer if you use on the outside, and you will see the signs that will take you to the washrooms. If by chance there's an emergency, push any door. All the doors are open. Push any door and get out. We do not believe we are going to have one, but just in case, just push a door and get out. You can push the back doors, any door. Thank you so much. We are going to begin on time. Melodies are gone. Okay, good morning again, everybody. We are about to begin our song service. And could we have your attention, please, as we have a short word of prayer so that we can begin. Let us bow our heads. Father, we thank you for the morning so far. We pray that you would be with us now as we sing. Let's sing. Let's rejoice. Let's praise the Lord. Marilyn was a happy lady, and we are going to praise your name. So bless us as we sing, in Jesus' name.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. For those of you who have your songbooks or hymnal, it's 663 in the SDA, but it's a universal song. It's known by most of us, if not all of us. So we all will make a joyful noise unto the Lord this morning. Let's go together.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us.
Everybody singing now. Oh, when
we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim's pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sound. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing. We'll sing and show the victory. Let us say, be true and faithful, trust in serving every day. Just one glimpse of him will the joys of life repair. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Oh, when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Onward to the prize.
Onward to the prize before us. Soon his beauty will be known. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Oh, when we all see Jesus, we will say,
for us one more time. For us one more time.
Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Oh, when we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory.
In the sweet by and by, we hope to meet on that beautiful shore. There's a land that is fairer than day.
One, two.
Let's together.
There's a land that is fairer than day. And by faith we can see it afar. Oh, the Father went over the way to prepare us.
shore. Oh, we shall sing on that beautiful shore. The melodious songs of the blessed, and those spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessings of grace. In the sweet, by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To a bountiful Father above, we will offer a tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessings that hallow day. In the sweet, by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
When the roll is called up yonder, when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, 216 is the amen. Together.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saints of old shall gather over on the other shore, and the road is called up yonder, I'll be there.
On that bright and glorious morning,
when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of His resurrection shine,
when His chosen one shall gather,
overrun
the shore,
and the road is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Everybody sing it together.
Let us labor for the Master from the mountain setting sun. Let us talk of all His wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the road is all of yonder, I'll be there.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine, and He's our assurance even at this point in time when we need Him most.
Blessed assurance, Jesus.
Standing, I just want to share with you two numbers. We have been cooperating so far, and we are asking motorists to continue doing that. PCR 1889 PBW 6327. PCR 1889 PBN, look like a W, 6327. Please cooperate with us because we know that the parking space is very tight, and so we just want your cooperation. Thank you so much.
You don't know. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction, and sayest, return ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood, they are as asleep. In the morning they are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 80 years. And if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is there strength, labor, and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and we fly away. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom.
Okay, let us bow our heads for prayer. Almighty Father, thou who art the giver of all good things, we come before you at this time to thank you for the life of our dear sister departed. Father, it was not your intention at the beginning, but man made a choice that has brought sickness, pain, loss, and even death. But we want to thank you this morning that you are the resurrection and that you are the life. Yes. And you have come to the human family so that we can experience joy while we live in this world of sin. Yes. We know, dear God, that a better day is coming.
Oh, yes.
When all these things shall be something of the past, there'll be no more need for the doctor, no more need for the undertaker, but there'll be life forevermore.
Amen.
We pray for the bereaving family at this time, that you continue to be with them, continue to bless them, and help, dear God, that all that would be said and done here today will be a means of bringing peace and comfort and solace to everyone.
Yes.
So into your hands we commit this service. We pray that your presence would reign supremely with us today. And we want to thank you for the blessings that we would receive at the end of this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please remain standing.
Good morning, everyone. Our song to continue this morning is hymn number 462 for those of you who have hymnals. And on the song sheet is the very first song that is on the song sheet. We already sang it, but we're going to sing it again in Jesus' name.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a fullness of glory divine! Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood.
Be seated. Praise the Lord. I must say that this is the first time.
I need to move right away.
Okay. PCR 1889, please attend to your vehicle. And folks, let's try our best not to park in a way that we have to say this over and over and over. But we'll do our best, to do the best thing. PCR 1889. I was saying that this is the first time we've been having so many people at any one time for a funeral service. You know, we had other services here, like crusades and so on, but for a funeral service, it's the biggest. I want to welcome everybody. Thank you. This is what Sister Austin did, bring out everybody. Sister Marilyn was a lovely woman, a really nice lady to us here in the church, and in general, I guess to you, that's why you made an effort to come out. Thank you so much. I want to bring you up to date again, one more time. All bathrooms are in the back, both male and female. If you want to go to the bathroom, you can sit right next to this gentleman and go to the back, and you will see the signs. We'll lead you to the washrooms. On the outside, if you want to pass on the outside, and those on the outside, just go all the way down to the back and follow the signs, and you will be there. If by chance there is an emergency and you need to use the door, door one, door two in the front, door right here, doors in the back, push any door and get out if there is an emergency. We do not expect any emergency, but just in case, at least you know where to go. Okay, so then I want to pause to recognize assemblymen and special people. I first want to recognize Dr. Lancelot Austin. Give him a round of applause. He's a good man. He is the husband of the person who is in that beautiful box. And we want to recognize you greatly, sir. May God bless you real good. His son is next to him. Want to recognize him also. And then we want to recognize Assemblyman Sheldon Cunningham, Assemblywoman Denise Sawyerfat Angus. I understand they say even though he's a woman, you must say Assemblyman. Huh? Presiding officer. Well, she used to be an Assemblywoman, so I'm just, no, she was never? Okay, all right. So, presiding officer, Dr. Denise Angus Sawyerfat. I say it upside down, right? Dr. Denise Sawyerfat Angus. Amen. Good to see you this morning, and God bless you real good. And then we want to recognize Assemblyman Sheldon Cunningham. I know I can't miss that one for sure. That's my good buddy. And then I also want to recognize Assemblywoman Shamfa Kojo. But this is where she started in Tobago, so, and then now I must transfer now. She is now the Minister for Sports. Glad to see you this morning. Oh boy, that's my very, very good friend also from a long time ago. Am I right, Tis? And then I also want to recognize Minister Ayanna Webster Roy. I have that one straight? That's my cousin. Praise the Lord. I know that one for sure. 1, 2, 3, 4. I hope I covered everybody this morning. Do you have anybody? Anybody else? Those are the names that I was given. No. Wait. Not Chief Secret. No. You all give me a break. I'm seeing a gentleman there who I know is an assemblyman. Yes? But I don't know your name, sir. Good. Hector. Good. Glad to see you this morning. Now, anywhere I go, I just have fun, you know. Funeral, wedding, anything. You must have fun in Jesus' name. Not so? We are glad to see you, sir. God bless you. Any other assemblymen? Yes. I'm seeing the one who is very popular on the television. Right. I don't know. I know your name, but I'm not remembering it right now. Help me out. Mr. Help me out. Kwesi Divines. Recognize you, sir, in the name of Jesus. And then, did I miss out anybody else so far? Sister, I'm seeing a hand. Let me come down here so that I could get the name. I'm not so sure. Yes. So, Esther Lejeune. Tell me who you are, lady. Former minister of the PNM, of the government. Oh, yes, I remember you now. That's nice. Let me see if I'm, then I know this lady here very well. Sister Maslin Belvin Jack. Amen. All right. And I saw this lady on the television also. And this lady is assemblywoman also, right? Counselor Nadine Stewart. Phillips. That's your husband? Okay. I'm having a good time. I could tell you that for sure. I'm having a good time. Did I miss out anybody? Right. So now I must recognize the chief. Yes, I know the chief for sure. And I know his name. What is his name? Chief Secretary of the Tobago House of Assembly, Mr. Kelvin P. You all don't know your chief secretary name? I don't understand. Chief, they don't know your name. Let me try that one more time. What is the chief secretary name? One by one. Mr. Kelvin. Mr. Kelvin P. Jack. B. V as in Victor. Right. Everybody, we welcome you specially. I'm seeing an assemblyman over here. Look, one more was assemblyman over here. That's my everyday customer. Good to see you. God bless you all real good. Everybody having a good time? We here to have a good time today, you know. Marilyn was a happy lady, and we're going to have a real good time, praising the name of the Lord with her. Okay, and then we want to recognize all the public servants, those who work with Sister Marilyn over the years. Just give me a high sign. I can't call all the names wherever you are. I'm seeing some in the back and so on. So we are here this morning to put our sister to rest until Jesus comes. And I want you all to know that she was a very faithful member of this church. That post right in the back there, where those folks are sitting right by that post, that's what's her seat. That's where she sits every single Sabbath. And so we want to thank you all for coming out, and may God bless you all real good as we praise his name today. Today is going to be a good day. It's already a nice day, and we are just going to praise the name of the Lord. All right, so we want to continue with special music. Brother Alfie? Okay, let's do that first. All right, we want to do some open tributes, and we want to run it in this way. We're going to have music amateurs will sing first, and then we are going to have some remarks from the Moravian community, and then we are going to have open floor, maybe just two or three persons, and we will travel from there as we go along. Let us welcome the music amateurs. Give them a round of applause as they come on.
Thank you.
Caribbean community.
It is indeed a day of mixed emotions, but for those of us who understand that while we live, we are preparing to meet our Maker, those of us who understand that God is with us in every trial, those of us who understand that the community is stronger when we have persons of the caliber of Sister Austin, and seek in our own daily lives to add glow to life, to add peace to others, to encourage and to live an exemplary life. I am certain you are happy that we encountered Sister Austin, worked with Sister Austin, lived with Sister Austin, laughed with her, cried with her, and ministered unto her. I am Esther Moore Roberts, the superintendent of the Moravian Church Tobago Conference, and I stand here to represent all of the Moravians and Dr. Austin and his family who are active at Spring Garden Moravian Church. So I want to say to the family heartfelt condolences. And faithful to God. For we are reminded that we have a high priest who understands what we feel in our infirmities. We have a high priest who walked this earth and who has gone ahead of us to prepare a place, and he will not lie. And so I want, even as we grieve, when we move on from today, to remember that we too need to exemplify the qualities that we have seen in our sister and in so many other excellent people who have touched this landscape. So once again, on behalf of the Moravian Church community, pastors, members, and all, we want to extend our heartfelt condolences to you, Dr. Austin, the family, and the workers, co-workers, relatives and friends, and the membership and the ministry here at the Good News Church. God bless us all.
Okay, we want to thank you so much. We want to continue with just about two or three open condolences. We would appreciate it very much if you could come and say what you have to say, and don't say what you have to say and then say, I have to sing a song. You know that kind of story? It normally happens. So, okay, so that's number one.
Good morning to pastor, elders, and all the very distinguished persons here today. I'm standing on behalf of the Tobago Council Women's League. Although you cannot hear your voice or see your smile no more, your mother walks beside you still, just as she did before. She listens to your stories and she wipes your tears away. She wraps her arms around you and she understands your fears. It's just she isn't visible to see with human eyes, but talk to her in silence and her spirit will reply. You'll feel the love she has for you. You'll hear her in your heart. She's left her human body, but her soul will never part. So again, on behalf of the PNM's Women's League, on behalf of the Office of the Prime Minister, and on behalf of the Roy family, Kevin, Anson, and all of us, I extend sincere condolences to Mr. Jack and to Betty. We love you. We have you in our hearts and our prayers. And may God continue to bless you all. And may her soul rest in peace. Thank you.
Okay, we'll just take two more. Anybody open? Just want to say a word? Thank you. Somebody else is standing by. Just please stand by. Come on up. Save every second.
Morning, everyone. Just want to acknowledge the Chief Secretary, Presiding Officer, Assemblyman, and my Minister, Minister Ayanna Webster-Roy. I knew Mrs. Jack Austin when I was in the Auditor General Department. She used to visit us very often. Lovely lady, charming woman with a beautiful smile. When I joined the Ministry of Tobago Development, she was the administrative officer for there. And I cannot remember a day when she was absent from work. Very regular, very punctual, very professional in her work, very reliable, very efficient. She represents a dying breed of public officers. In the public service that carry themselves well and knew what service, especially public service, was all about. So on behalf of all the staff, Central Administrative Services Tobago, who worked with her, I want to say to Deputy Secretary Joel Jack, who I also worked with in finance, and to your family, may God comfort and strengthen you, and I know that she's in a better place today.
All right, thank you so much. Could we take one more? One, two, three, four, five, six, okay.
Good morning to everyone. I'd like to extend condolences to the bereaved family. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Then sings my soul, then sings my soul. Oh Lord, my God, when
so much. Clear? Ready? We're going to have a scripture reading now by our grandbaby.
Good morning, everybody. The scripture reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 19 to 23. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. But now in Christ risen from the dead, and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ's at his coming. Thank you.
At this time, we shall have another special music by one Tinil Solomon as she arrives. Let's give her a good amen there, please. Thank you very much.
Pleasant afternoon to everyone. Well, good morning. My apologies. Life is easy when you're upon the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But things change when you're down in the valley. But don't lose faith, for you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. God of the day is still God in the night. We talk of faith when we're way up on the mountain, but talk comes so easy when life's at its best. Now it's down in the valleys, trials and temptations, that's where your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, by God, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. Oh, the God of the day is still God in the night. Oh, the God of the day still God in the night.
Amen. And that's the real word. That's my wife's favorite song. And she's shouting amen over there. Good. Thank you, Tenille. Always nice to hear you sing. And that's a true song, eh? The daytime God is the nighttime God, and the nighttime God is the daytime God. Am I right now? Wherever and wherever in the world you are, same God, same God. Thank you so much. All right, so what we want to do now, we want to go to special tributes. And this is how we're going to do it. Tobago, Mission of Seventh-day Adventists first. Then we will do the Division of Finance and Economy. And then we are going to go to the Precious Gems Group, wherever they are. Then we're going to take the Scarborough Secondary School class of 1968. We want to run in that order. Let me do it one more time. Tobago Mission of SDA, Division of Finance, the Precious Gems, and then we're going to have the Scarborough class of 1968.
On behalf of the president of the Tobago Mission, Pastor Tony Mapp, who is unavoidably absent, I want to extend condolences to the family of Sister Marilyn Austin. She has been a beloved member of this Good News Church and a member of the Tobago Mission of Seventh-day Adventists. And like the family, we'll miss her because she's a part of our family also. But praise God, when we lose our loved ones here, we have the blessed hope that if they lived in the Lord, they also die in the Lord. And blessed are the dead that die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, see the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works to follow them. So, on behalf of the Tobago Mission of Seventh-day Adventists, I extend condolences to the family. And I trust that all of us look forward to that great day, that great resurrection day, when Jesus will come to call all those who died in him.
Permit me to acknowledge the Chief Secretary of the Tobago House of Assembly, the Honorable Kelvin Charles, the Presiding Officer of the Tobago House of Assembly, Dr. Denise Hoyofat Angus, and all other secretaries and assistant secretaries of the Tobago House of Assembly, the Chief Administrator, Mr. Ray Sandy, and all my colleagues, distinguished persons in the congregation, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. A mother's love is peace. It needs not be deserved. She's a pillar of strength and a reservoir of hope, with a heart so large that everybody's joy finds welcome in it. Today, we celebrate the life of a phenomenal mother, an extraordinary woman, Mrs. Marilyn Jerry Austin.
On behalf of the staff of the Division of Finance and Economy, and on my own behalf as administrator of the division, I wish to extend sincerest condolences to Assemblyman Joel Jack, Secretary of the Division, and the rest of his family. The finance family, and indeed the rest of the Assembly, share your enormous grief and pain at this time. I can tell you from personal experience that losing your parent or loved one is never easy. I lost my father over 20 years ago, and I still miss him. Secretary, I can tell you from experience that at first you don't want to remember. So you immerse yourself in something, anything. Then you remember with unnerving pain and grief. And then, many, many years later, you remember with a smile that represents all the gratitude you feel for having shared in their life, a smile that embodies the hope for reunion, and a smile that signifies the peace that you have found. Time, with all its goodness and mercy, would have taken you to that place of peace. The psalmist David says to us, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. So let the many pleasant memories you've had with your mother sustain you and the rest of your family at this time. As you reflect on these memories, you will realize how blessed you are to have been able to share the life of your mother. A mother's love inspires and creates a resolute purpose in the heart of a child, especially a son. Mrs. Marilyn Jerry Austin is someone I knew quite well and considered a good friend. In fact, during my early working years in the public service, I had the pleasure of working with her in the check staff unit at CAS. I can tell you that she was a committed, gracious, respectable worker, and we had an excellent and very close working relationship. In fact, our relationship extended beyond the workplace, and on many Sundays, as well as time of social activities like harvest, we visited each other's home and had wide-ranging discussions. Also, we were sisters in faith. And when she visited my church, I would drive her home. So you could understand why I consider Mrs. Austin a dear friend. Over the years, I always knew her as a kind-hearted and humble person, a woman of tremendous strength. She was a fun-loving person, and when I think of her, I see her laughing. And throughout the most difficult of challenges, she never lost that infectious laugh and winsome giggle. I benefit immensely from the relationship we shared. And even now, as I am reminded that there are things that we don't want to happen, but we have to accept. Things we don't know, but we have to learn. And people we can't live without, but we have to let go. I remain eternally grateful for the indelible imprint of fond memories made, memories that will be forever cherished. We will all miss the presence of a truly lovable and kind person, and are indeed blessed to have been inspired by her company and her counsel, as our lives have undoubtedly been enriched by sharing in her warmth. Secretary, Deidre, James, our thoughts and prayers are with you and the rest of your family at this difficult time. Dr. Austin, may God give you the strength and fortitude to take you through. We know that the love of God will surround and comfort you and the rest of the family at this time. Secretary, once again, on behalf of the staff of the Division of Finance and the Economy, and on my own behalf as administrator, let me extend heartfelt condolences to you and the rest of your family on the passing of your mother. I pray that your hearts be filled with wondrous memories of joyful times together as we celebrate a life well lived. For it is said that wherever a beautiful soul has been, there is a trail of beautiful memories. As I conclude, permit me to leave the words of Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross with you. Those who learn to know death rather than fear it become our teachers about life. May that peace of a mother's love provide you with comfort. May you draw from that reservoir of strength, and may it raise you up, and may God bless you and the rest of your family during this time. I thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Division of Finance. And we should be having our precious gems standing by. Before that, PDJ 3578, you are blocking the entrance. Nobody could come in, nobody could get out. Could you kindly attend to your vehicle? PDJ 3578. Thank you. Let's have precious gems. Right after that, we are going to have the group design before we take the Scarborough secondary class of 1968.
Brothers and sisters, on behalf of the group Precious Gems, we extend heartfelt sympathy to the husband, Dr. Lancelot Austin, children, Deputy Chief Secretary, Assemblyman Joel Jack, Deidre Jack, and James Jack. Brothers, sisters, grandchildren, extended family and friends mourning the passing of Marilyn, or Mary, as we fondly called her. This group, Precious Gems, is comprised of retired public officers. Three friends were getting together over a meal on a regular basis, sharing good times and bad times, and in due course, other retirees became aware of their activities. They requested that they become part of the group and were happy to come on board. The creative juices flowed. The group grew to 16 persons and adopted the name Precious Gems. That's our history in a nutshell. Marilyn was a member of this group. We have celebrated many milestones over the years, and this is the first deceased member. Today, we mourn the passing of Marilyn. We celebrated many of her birthdays, among other activities. Some she attended, some she couldn't, but we knew that she was always there in spirit. Her last outing with the group was when we celebrated her birthday this year, with a special luncheon. We all had a beautiful time together. These last months, we supported and cheered her on as we witnessed her pain. Throughout her challenges, she continued to carry herself with the dignity, grace, and class that she has always displayed. We loved Mary. We enjoyed her friendship in the workplace and in retirement. We will always cherish those precious memories that we shared with her. I remember Marilyn as being the well-dressed, best-dressed public servant in our era. I don't think anyone has replaced her since. We prepared a small tribute in poem to a beautiful woman of purpose in the person of Marilyn Grace Austin. God did not promise days without pain, laughter without sorrow, or sun without rain. Death has put an ending to the woman of the earth, but to her soul, it is a new beginning, the triumph of life. Death removes the sense of touch, but not our awareness and the memories. Memories of joy, of goodness, happy, loving moments over the years. In her new reality, if Marilyn will speak, we think this sorrowful interlude would prove sweeter than the joy of sweet music. God has promised strength for the day. comfort for the tears and light for the way. Life on earth has ended for our beloved, and we believe that she continues to live forever and better in the next life where Jesus is. Mourners, you have laughed. He who has not experienced sorrow will never feel the exhilarations of joy. Rest in peace, Marilyn, and may your soul rise again in glory.
The group designed from this very church. Thank you so much, design class of 2000. The class of 1968. You're there? All right. So good to see you, Stanley Bell. These are the youths. Amen. The youths of 1968. Some of them here have turned white, but they're still young. Amen.
This is it? Oh, yes. I'm accustomed to mics. The class of 1968. We've had wonderful years in that place called Scarborough Government Secondary. We enjoyed our years, even though they robbed us of one. We went in 64, and they threw us out in 68. Anyway, I want just simply to say that the group is about 2 years old now. We felt that we were getting up in age and that we should try and relive the years in Scarborough Secondary. So what we did, we started a chat room. And every day, we touch base with each other. And we have been going like this for about 2 years. I am going to just simply say a few words, and Sister Beth is going to say what has to be said. We don't meet people by accident. Understand that. They are meant to cross our paths for some reason. We believe that. Marilyn was one of those persons who crossed our paths in 68, in 64, to 68. Some people come into our lives and leave footprints. Marilyn has footprints on our hearts, and we are never ever the same. I'm going to say that none of us standing on this podium is the same from having the experience of Scarborough Government Secondary School and being brothers and sisters together for those 4 years. Thank you.
I continue. The classmates of the Scarborough Secondary School 1964 to 68 stand before you to pay our respects to Marilyn Jerry Jack Austin, our recently fallen sister. On that momentous day, January 14th, 1964, we assembled for the first time as Forms 1A, 1B, and 1C of the Scarborough Government Secondary School
then popularly referred to as Central School, under the then command of Principal George A. Callender, also known as Baldy. Little did we know or realize then how persons entering our young lives would create various impacts or influences which would help us to better understand and appreciate ourselves or the life and world in which we live. With the passage of time, however, we the Class T's of 1964 to 68 now proudly affirm and attest to the fact that our sister Marilyn had been one of those beautiful and unforgettable persons with whom we had the honor and the pleasure to have interfaced, played games, broke bread, and spent many meaningful and enlightening hours as students at Central. Together, we reflect and remember Marilyn as having the name Grace, befitting of her personality, always being graceful in comportment, never without that warm and friendly smile. Marilyn was caring, well-mannered, cultured, and unassuming, remaining in the background, however, would participate in activities when invited. We know that she looked forward to celebrating her birthday January 31st, as she was sure to receive birthday cake from Marsha's mother, as they shared the same birth date. Marilyn possessed a quiet, ladylike persona, soft-spoken and always neatly dressed, never uttering an unkind word to or about anyone. As a member of the debating team, she was articulate, demonstrated clear diction and sound memory, qualities of one destined to succeed in life. Marilyn, as we all did, enjoyed our four-year stay at Central, as she would always be ready to reflect on the fond memories we took away upon our graduation from the farm school. And we say farm school because we were located next to Government Farm. At the time, Government Farm was down there. 50 years have passed since we went our separate ways. Yet, despite our absence or lack of communication, Marilyn's personality remained the same. Warm, friendly, and yes, the smile. Even in failing health, she found the time to share prayers and conversations with classmates, some of us sharing stronger bonds with her than others. At this time, we extend our deepest and heartfelt condolences to you, her family, friends, and well-wishers. Dr. Austin, we know that God will strengthen you for this passage in your life. We share your grief, and we know that her passing is a profound loss to you. Revelation chapter 21, verse 4 says in part, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." Rest in peace, our dear sister and friend, Marilyn, forever with the Lord.
Thank you so much, class of 1968. Give them another round of applause. That's a nice group. All right. Okay, there's a little column that says, take your time, Brother Stanley. Good. There's a little column in your leaflet that says letters and cards and so on. We only have one card, and that's good. We want to just read one little thing from it. It says, "Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. The Almighty Father comfort and strengthen you all during this time of grief." And this is coming from the monks in George Seventh-day Adventist Church, and we want to praise the Lord for that. "My dearest Marie," I don't know who it comes from as yet, "my dearest Marie, there are no words to describe what our 40 years of friendship with you has meant to me. What I do know for sure is that I understand the true meaning of a friend. I will miss you immensely. From the very beginning, you had been a comfort and constant light as a reminder that you were always, and always in capital letters, big time, always there to talk to. It didn't matter the reason or reasons, you never waver in showing your willingness to turn to me as one would to a big sister. You may no longer be with us, but you will forever, big words, big, bold, forever remain in my heart. Sleep in God, amen. Sleep in God's eternal peace, my beloved friend, and keep shining your light on all of us whose life you have touched. I don't know who it came from, but God bless. God bless. Real good. All right.
Good morning, everyone. We have received so many cards, tokens, etc., so we're not going to read all of them. Many persons sent well wishes, Joel. We have cards here from Auntie Monica, from Pushpa, from Auntie Bernadette. But I stand here on behalf of Joel, Deirdre, and James, on behalf of all your mommy's sisters and brothers, Auntie Monica, Auntie Rose, Auntie Jennifer, Auntie Herman, Auntie Betty or Elizabeth, Auntie Nyla, Auntie Bernadette, and Auntie Arlene, Uncle Wilkie and Uncle Winston, who was recently deceased, and your 45 cousins. We wish you all heartfelt condolences. Auntie Marilyn, as her sisters called her, Sister Marilyn, was like a mother to all of us. And anyone who knows our family knows that we tight, and close. So everything that you had to do had to be passed through each and every one of the aunts and uncles and then approved. My mom, Auntie Betty, and Auntie Marilyn were like twins. And we stand here this morning, Auntie Arlene and I, my husband Marcus, letting you know that we share in your grief and we celebrate all the beautiful memories that we have created over the years. Auntie Marilyn is smiling at the turnout this morning. She will be well pleased with all we have done to celebrate her life here. Uncle Anne's, we are here for you. Again, Joel, Deirdre, and James, we are here for you. Auntie Marilyn, rest in peace. We love you.
Praise the Lord. Okay, what are we going to do? The women ministries of this Good News Church, in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we have so many departments. We have the AY department and the women ministries department and the adult department, the men ministries and so on. Right now, we have the Good News Women Ministries, who Sister Marilyn was a member of that little group, and they are going to do something for us now. Before they come, I want you to know that in this church where it is placed here, a whole lot of things happen. It is not just another Adventist church, but what really happened, seeing that we are placed in the middle of town, we decided to do something for people. So every Monday and every Thursday, we take all those guys on the streets who walk up and down without food and without clothes and so on. We bring them in, clean them up, feed them up, and clothe them up. Thank you. Yes. And I'm saying every Monday and every Thursday. I did not say every Christmas. And I want you to take note of that. And so we clean them up, make sure they have food. If you see any guys around town walking dirty, it's because they don't want to change their clothes. And once they come here, that little boot you see in the front there, that's where we have all the clothing and little perfume and shoes and so on and so on. We make sure we take care of them. And so because of that, after we would listen to the remarks from our chief secretary, we want to raise an offering. Permission was given to us by the members of the family to do this. And so we want to take up an offering. Please help us feed the people and clothe them. Is that all right with you? Good. Thank you so much. We do a whole lot of other things, but we just want you to know just that little part there. All right. So now what we're going to do, we're going to have women ministries. After the women ministries, I would want to introduce the chief secretary for the Tobago House of Assembly. He will do the last address. And we want to thank him really for coming. Mr. Charles, we're really happy that you came by. And God bless you and your family. Real good. The leader of the women ministries. And then.
Good morning, everybody. I bring condolences on behalf of the Good News Women's Ministry. I am Mrs. Lorraine Paul Perry, and Sister Marilyn was a member of the Good News Women's Ministry Department. She always assisted in whatever way possible, and she always had a word of advice for others. She was extremely friendly and always wore that beautiful smile. Today she's gone, but she will always be remembered in our hearts. And today our deepest condolences goes out to the members of the bereaved family, and you too will be remembered in our prayers. I have a very short poem. Don't grieve for me, for I'm now free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard his call. I turned my back and left it all. I could not stay another day to laugh, to work, to love, to play. Tasks left undone must stay that way. I found that peace at the close of the day. If my parting has left a void, then fill it with remembered joy. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss. Ah, yes, these things will be surely missed. Be not burdened with times of sorrow. I wish you the sunshine of tomorrow. My life's been full. I've savored much. Good friends, good times, a loved one's touch. Perhaps my time seemed all too brief. Don't lengthen it now with too much grief. Lift up your heart and share with me. God wanted me now. He set me free. So you will be remembered in our prayers at this time. Thank you very much.
Sister Joan Morris, okay, coming up. This is the real body of Sister Marilyn. They sit together, they talk together, they go together, they do everything together. Go ahead, Sister Joan.
Good morning, everyone. All protocol observed. After to come at this point in the service, it would be a hard act to find new words to say about the same deceased person. However, I'll continue. Sister Marilyn Grace, and I'm stressing on the word Grace, Austin, was indeed a very graceful woman. I do not know if her mother was a prophet, but when I look at her, I see elegance and beauty of movement, pleasing and charming person, very courteous and a very decent person. All these are graceful attitudes. At first, I met Sister Marilyn very early in my working life as a public servant at the Works Division, the old Works Building. She was one of my senior officers, and I did admire her very much. She was an officer I could have gone to for directions or further clarity on any aspect of my job assignment I was unsure of. We were good work colleagues, but not really friends. We started to attend Good News SDA Church at around the same time. We were so happy to reconnect that we quickly became good friends and we worshiped the Lord together. As superintendent at church, she was one of my main supporting cast. She had a beautiful, godly voice for proclaiming God's word. She would contribute ideas and give opinions for the programs during the planning stage, and then praise and encourage me in the Lord after the programs were executed. She was a great moral support, and she will be surely missed. Any tasks at all she was given at church, she would gladly do it, even though she wasn't feeling well. She was a member of the women's ministry of the church and supported and contributed all the programs planned. Sister Marilyn had a very powerful testimony, which I will share with the congregation this morning. Because it was her burning desire that her children and her relatives and friends would follow in her footsteps. She said that one night as she was sleeping, had this powerful dream where Jesus told her or asked her, "Marilyn, why aren't you worshiping me on my Sabbath day? Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy." She said, try as she may, she could not get it out of her mind. And so she got up and after agonizing with Jesus in her prayers, she decided to follow his instructions and give in to her dream. You see, she was a very ardent member of another church, and she was very active in that church, and she had loved that congregation very dearly. However, she had listened to the voice that spoke to her, and she returned to church and was rebaptized. Sister Marilyn, the Good News SDA Church, and myself will really miss you. So long, my friend. Goodbye.
Amen. Let us welcome the Chief Secretary of the Tobago House of Assembly, Mr. Kelvin V. Charles. Please.
Good morning, church. I take this opportunity to recognize the honorable ministers who were here but had to leave because of pressing matters of state in Trinidad. I want to recognize the presiding officer of the Tobago House of Assembly, Dr. Denise Oyavat-Angus. I want to recognize my colleagues in the Executive Council, permanent secretaries and administrators that are here, and in this regard, I want to, on behalf of the chief administrator, say that he apologizes, but he was forced to travel to Trinidad in an emergency situation, and that is why he's not here. Distinguished members of this church, pastors, and other members of the cloth, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and you would pardon me if I recognize someone in the audience who gave me a hard time when I was a student, but whom I love dearly, and it is someone whose name I call all the time. I see Marceline is smiling. My good friend, Una Austin. She's trying to hide in the audience, or in the congregation. Heartfelt condolences are in order to Dr. Lance Austin, someone whom I know very well, but whom I have not seen in quite a while, and members of his family, Assemblyman Joel Jack, and your family, James, and Deirdre, and the rest of the family of Mrs. Marilyn, Jerry, Jack Austin. And when I saw the program, I realized that she's also known by the word, or the name, Grace. And we heard a lot about that earlier today. Whilst there is much to be sad about as we mourn the loss of a wife, mother, sister, friend, there is also so much to rejoice about, as God would have loaned her to all of us for 60 plus years. Sometimes it is in death that we can realize how blessed we are. I don't know if to say to Joel and his siblings that they are a bit more fortunate than I am, because I lost my mother when I was only 6 years old. So that I normally say to persons, please enjoy your parents, especially your mother, and in fact, honor them so that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God hath given thee. So I really never got the opportunity to enjoy a long-lasting love and relationship with my mother. And even now, sometimes I am pained because I can't speak to that experience. But even as we remember the life of Sister Marilyn, it is a wonderful thing that we would have heard so many glowing tributes about her life and personality. So as I sat there and I was listening, there is one word that came to my mind to describe her, because as the speaker before me indicated, so many good things would have been said, and I don't think I want to bore you with a repetition of those adjectives. But it is clear that Marilyn was a quintessential personality, because we heard words like graceful, kind, sweet, gentle, etc., etc. In my own reflection, three things come to mind: positivity, personality, and influence. And if we think of all of these things in the context of why we are here today, there are lessons for all of us. I suggest, quite humbly, that given the depth of love and outpouring that we would have seen and witnessed today is a clear indication that she was a positive individual who not only attracted positive energy into her life, but also exuded that positivity. Her personality was one that attracted and invited people, and therefore persons liked to be in her presence, sharing in the positivity and sharing in the welcoming and bright personality that made one feel very special. Sister Marilyn, maybe even without realizing it, had influence. Her very nature and soul touched and impacted others to think differently, act differently, and live differently. And indeed, we heard the injunction that she would like, as a tribute to her memory and legacy, if we as a people and as a community can emulate or copy some of her endearing attributes. In her own quiet way, Almighty God would have used her to show others how to be Christ-like, loving, and kind-hearted. Brothers and sisters, as we reflect, reminisce on the life of Sister Marilyn, arguably we see a model citizen. As I said, a citizen of positivity, beautiful personality, and influence. How wonderful would it be to have an island and even a country with such souls? What a different place Trinidad and Tobago would be. I therefore would like to challenge all of us here today. In fact, I'll be negligent if I didn't do that. As we gather with the family of Marilyn, let us not only think and speak about her in glowing ways, but let us allow her life and influence to impact us in such a way that we become better, more positive, more kind-hearted, more caring citizens of this great nation of Trinidad and Tobago. The most important thing about us as a people, or as humans, is our capacity to create, to overcome, to endure, to transform, to love, and to be greater than our own suffering. Seashells remind us that every passing life leaves behind something that is beautiful. And therefore, to the husband and family of Marilyn, and of course to the children, words are never enough to comfort one in their grief or times like this. But Marilyn, in essence, was a light. And I wish to suggest to you that death for Marilyn, or her death, ought to be seen as not the extinguishing of a light, but rather the turning out of the lamp because the dawn has come. And therefore, what we have once enjoyed, we can never lose, because all that we love deeply over time becomes part of us. And as I depart, I want to take this opportunity once again to commiserate with the bereaved and trust that you would find peace as you grieve. And for Marilyn, My wish is that she rests in eternal peace. I thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Chief Secretary. Anybody hungry today? Yes. You all ready for food? Yes. You all at licorice. School feeding has given today. No school feeding today, Mr. Chief Sec, right? No grub today. I know some of you, this is grub time for you, you know. So just keep the peace. We shall be ending in an hour or two in a while. So don't be afraid at all. There's a young man by the name of God James. He shall be presenting special music to us, after which we shall have the eulogy by Deirdre. Right, Deirdre, you ready to go? But before you come, but God James will present to us special music. Nobody's hungry again? Amen. Think God James is coming. Lovely. Lovely. We're doing good.
Good morning, church. I was asked to sing, not to talk, but before I do the singing, it is to put the song in context, it is really a blessing to see the blessing, to understand this morning the blessing that Sister Marilyn has been to so many of us. Yes, sir. And her life certainly reminds us of the blessing, the love, the mercy, and the grace that God has bestowed on us through Jesus Christ. And this is a good opportunity for us to pay tribute to our God. How can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I give it all, I owe it all to you. To God
save.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
God is good. And all the time. This is a phrase, once my mom was on the podium, this is a phrase you were bound to hear her say. And the next phrase is, it's always a good thing when people are gathered together in the house of the Lord. We recently lost my uncle, Winston, and I did his eulogy, and afterwards, mommy was heard to say, now I'm sure you could do mine. So I hope I do justice to the life and the love. And it's so good to hear that song just before I come up, because it reminds us that we have been greatly, richly blessed to have this woman in our lives. Today we celebrate the life of a woman of strong character and virtue. She was revered as a wife, mother, sister, relative, classmate, co-worker, and friend. She was a woman of faith who believed and practiced the obedience and fear of God. She was a woman who I often termed a silent warrior, but normally I called her mommy. Marilyn Grace Jerry, born to Albert and Iris Jerry, was number 8 of 11 siblings. She grew up in the beautiful village of John Dials. Her siblings have memories of her being the defender, often willing to go up against the elders in the protection of her family, always willing to give her opinion on matters. Their love affair continued even though most of her siblings migrated, but she was always happy to visit them. Her favorite time was Thanksgiving, not only for the shopping, but it was the best time for all of them to be together. Her main base was at her sister Arlene, who she treasured as the youngest sibling. But she had a special relationship with Auntie Betty, her sister Elizabeth, because they remained together in Tobago. She was meticulous about her appearance, as you've heard many people say today about her being a great dresser. My paternal grandfather had a saying, after character, garment. And my mother personified that throughout her life. Her sisters tell stories of the details and the steps she took to make sure that her socks were straight, her shirt was tucked in, and every hair was in place. I think that's why her father finally said, "You see, she? There goes the queen, the white lady." But mommy loved taking care of the family home. My grandmother, fondly referred to as sister, made sure her daughters knew how to take care of the household. But Marilyn took it to a next level. Her sister, Elizabeth, fondly remembers her attention to detail. But I don't know how fondly that is, since unless the house was spick and span to Marilyn's satisfaction, nobody could play. But she had an attention for detail. And that transcended even in her home. Now, she wasn't fond of planting, but you see, gardening, she transcended inside and outside. Her house is littered with flowers. So this is one of the things, as we see all the flowers here presented, I know her heart is pleased. Right. And her husband, the Dr. Lancelot Austin. He always was amazed at what she was able to achieve in the home. Sometimes he had to say, but this is not the house I left this morning. Once his friend visited from abroad, and he was so amazed, he had to film it for posterity and take it back so everyone could see what the house had become. She attended the Scarborough Methodist Primary School, the Scarborough Government Secondary School, and the Harmon School of FCA. As said before, she remained an avid member of the SGSS class of 68, and as expressed by them, they have fond memories of her throughout the year. After high school, Mommy entered the public service. She worked at many divisions of note, works, licensing, but most of her working years were spent at CAS, where she retired as the administrative officer for. Her co-workers remember her as a dedicated worker who was always willing to go the extra mile to assist where necessary. She was thought of as quiet, gentle, kind, classy, always well-dressed. She was a devoted friend. She gathered friends from all walks of life, all different personalities, but the one common was among her. Once she considered you her friend, she would be there for you through thick and thin. She was always there willing, always willing, to give a word of advice, to share some note with someone that she thought that it would envision them, it would make them feel better. She always had them in their thoughts. And she always had everybody's birthday written down so that she could call them to give them that encouragement. Mommy was a loving and attentive mother. She had assistance from some of the family, but the care and the detail she took in our lives created an amazing childhood, no matter the challenges. She made time for us even in our adulthood. And even though she raised us to be independent and self-sufficient, she felt she had the mommy card that gave her that extra ability to tell us what to do. She felt she had the extra stay. It was really uplifting to have her in your corner. But with all the love that she showed to us, her children, to her brothers and sisters and friends, that love moved into Uber Drive when she became a grandmother. To see her interact with her grandchildren was to experience love at its pinnacle. Their needs became a priority, clearing any engagement she had once she knew they would be visiting. She had started off with the precious gems, but she let them know, I have grandchildren now. My focus is on them. Their needs became a priority. Jerome, Chanel, Joel, and Clavia responded to her adoration in kind. To see their expressions once they heard her voice was pure joy. They would bypass everybody, sometimes including their parents, to make sure that they had hugs and kisses with grandma before they deigned to notice anybody else. And she had a deep relationship with God. Her faith was the basis of her existence, and she believed in his guidance and protection. She started off at the Mount St. George SDA Church, where she was an ardent participant, achieving the level of youth minister. When she married Dr. Austin, she believed in the unity of family, so she joined him to fellowship in Spring Garden Moravian Church, and she participated greatly. In fact, she was the secretary of the board and loved doing announcements. She was loved by the congregation and participated in many events that they had. However, she never forgot her foundation. And as Sister Morris said, she heard a voice from God saying it's time to come back home. With the blessing of her husband, she started attending Good News, where she remained till the end. The congregation loved her as she always participated, sometimes contributing silently, especially to the children's activities. Much earlier, I called her a silent warrior, because with all the sweetness, loving and kind-hearted, caring person that she was also very stubborn. If my mother believed that this is white, you could bring all the evidence, the parameters, you could show her the proof, and she would listen to you attentively, nod her head at you, and then went back, but you know it's white. And she was always willing to speak up and speak out. If she saw something as wrong, her conscience would bother her. She couldn't sleep unless she told that person, what you're doing is wrong. I think if you try this, it might be better. I heard you say something, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Her battle with cancer spread over 22 years, but she fought it with dignity and without fanfare. Her sisters were always amazed at her upbeat, positive attitude, but once she knew what she was supposed to do, she just did it. And she fought and kept battling until she could fight no more. Marilyn Grace Jerry Jack has lived a full life and left a lasting legacy through her children, grandchildren, family, and friends. We mourn deeply because we have lost a treasure. When we were asked to think about what we may want to speak of her biblically, Proverbs 31 came to mind, which said, who can find a virtuous woman, for her price is above rubies? And that is what mommy has been to a lot of us. But we mourn greatly as she was essential to us, but we mourn with a hope and a belief that once we live our lives emulating the steps that she took, we will see her again. May her soul rest in eternal peace. I have been asked to read this media release, which says, mother of Assemblyman Joel Jack being laid to rest today. The Office of the Chief Secretary joins the rest of Tobago in supporting the family of the late Mrs. Marilyn Jerry Jack Austin, mother of Assemblyman Joel Jack, Secretary of Finance and the Economy, during this time of loss. Chief Secretary Honorable Kelvin Charles highly commends Assemblyman Jack for his strength and fortitude during this period, as he had to attend to matters relating to the budget while simultaneously dealing with the grief of losing his own mother. I must especially congratulate and commend Secretary Joel Jack, for he has exhibited and continues to exhibit remarkable strength and composure during this time of mourning. In this instance, he has certainly put Ireland before self, and for that he must be recognized and acknowledged, says Honorable Kelvin Charles. On behalf of the Tobago House of Assembly and all of Tobago, the Office of the Chief Secretary extends sincerest condolences to the family and loved ones of the late Mrs. Marilyn Jerry Jack Austin. We encourage all of Tobago and by extension Trinidad to keep the family in prayer and offer as much love and support where possible as they go through this time of mourning. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Sister Deirdre. I think she's strong. Could you all give her another wake-up assembly? I think so. She's really strong. And she takes a bow. You know, as far as I know, she's the only daughter of Sister Marilyn. And she's a wonderful lady. And
She is Red Rose's granddaughter. Huh? Yes, I must say that. I'm supposed to say that. That's Cecile's father, Red Rose. Yes, that's the man who said before, no, he said garment after character is garment. Cecile, stand up and let him see you with your hat. She's a well-dressed woman all the time too, and always wears a hat. She looks good. Thank you. God bless you all. PDJ 258 and PDA 3702, please attend to your vehicle. And I think you should go quickly. This was a kind of urgent message. PDJ 258 and PDA 3702. Move. Okay, so this is the time we want to do the offering. We want you to give whatever you want to give. Just remember what I said to you. And while we are doing that, we are going to sing. Before we hear the message, we are going to sing, because you folks have been sitting for a while. Let's sing now. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Amen. So we're going to pick up the offering, so we're going to move through as quickly as possible, and then we prepare for the message. Sing the wonder. Mm-hmm. While we are taking up the offering. You all want to stand up and sing? It's a song that you could clap and relax and praise the Lord. So let's stand and sing. Let's stand up and sing. Sing, let's sing, let's sing. Sing for Marilyn. She can't hear you, but still sing. Everybody, everybody together.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions, bright and blessed, He prepared for us a place. For when we all get to heaven,
oh, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all
see Jesus.
people on this platform here, this young man is the first elder of the church, one by the Diamond Andrews. Stand and give him a little thing, man. What happened? Church elder, appreciate him, man. Right. Then there's a young lady to his side. She's one of the elders of our church, Lewis Hosford. Right. Then we swing on this side. Pastor Scott, the oldest pastor in Tobago. Look at his color of his hair. All right. He's retired, but he's still refiring. All right. Then we have the pastor of our church, Pastor Ian Kirk. Pastor Kirk, stand and give him a little thing, man. What happened? Brother Benji, our religious educator. Right, he walks along with the church here, and I am me, all right? Anybody else? Nobody else. Diamond wife is down there. Where Joy? Joy, where there? That is Diamond wife. She's also an elder of the church. All of you told me they miss Marilyn. I will miss Marilyn on Sabbath morning. Marilyn was a very miserable girl, you know. She said, come and sit down behind me. She and Joan, and always make mischief in the back of the church. But so Joan, you'll have to do a double boogie because Marilyn gone. Marilyn had me in church last week Wednesday night. I heard it first elder saying, when is the funeral for Marilyn? We don't know it. I said, Sayo, Marilyn dead? I was in church right there and I bawled like I thought I was crazy. I know Marilyn since in Harmon in Bacolet Street. Nyla, that is you? You understand? Let me see you now. I didn't know since Nyla leave Harmon, I never saw Nyla in all her life. Sit now, Nyla. Nyla was in class with my sisters, so I just kind of remembering the name Nyla. So you all permit me to do what I do, right? Permission granted? Whether granted or not, I have it already. Right. This young man grew up in the village of Concordia, but his grandparents and so on from the village of Mason Hall. But I saw you're one of the elders of the church. Sayo, come let them see you now, man. You're one of the elders of the church. Let the people see your face. Now, what happened to you? Just turn and give them a little wave. No, they don't come up here, you know. Just give them a wave. What do you come up here for?
If I'm an elder, then of course I'll.
Well, let them see you. Right. He's from Kendall via Signal Hill, right, Brother Sayo? Amen. I see another number coming. Lord have mercy. Call the white wrecker. Trouble take somebody. White wrecker is on its way. TCA 3021 and PDS 912. If you don't move your vehicle, the white wrecker is on its way. You know the white wrecker? Lift you up wherever you are and take you wherever he wants to take you. Right, so back to the introduction of this gentleman. He grew up in the village of Concordia. His parents and grandparents are Mason Hall, Mariah. He has been in ministry for the last 14 years. He got married 13 years ago. And I knew him as a little fine foot boy. At Harmon School, he used to do woodwork. He became the top student in woodwork in 1999. I had the privilege of teaching him then. But he's my pastor now. He has grown to be a big man, and he could real preach. I boast about him. He's a nice little boy. He's a nice little boy. So by the way, we also have another elder of our church, Landon Phillip. Where Landon there? Landon, stand there, see you now. You want me to tell you Lennox Phillip's son? He's an elder in this church. Right, very good boy, very poetic in nature. If you say your name, he put a poem to that. Right, so back to this little boy. And he's now a pastor of the Tobago Mission of Seventh Adventists. He's the communication director of the Tobago Mission of Seventh Adventists. He's now pastor in the Near East, that's Mason Hall and those areas. You're not talking near North, sorry, my apologies, Pastor Utley. His name is Lowell McCarty Johnson Utley. Don't call him that because I normally make up people's names. So don't call him that. He's going to charge you for I don't know what, right? But I want to introduce to you the preacher for today. He has word of comfort for us. His name is Lowell, Pastor Lowell Utley. Just buckle your seat belts. And let's welcome him to the podium this morning. Pastor Utley, it's over to you now.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I know the time is well spent, but permit me to acknowledge the Honorable Chief Secretary, Mr. Kelvin Charles, our presiding officer, Dr. Denise Hoyafat Angus, and the other THA personnel scattered in the audience. It's all out here today supporting the Jack and Austin families. We have Deidre, we have our beloved Deputy Chief Secretary and Secretary of Finance, Joel Jack. We have James Jack, we have James Austin in absentia, and also Brian Austin. We have Dr. Austin, and the siblings of Sister Marilyn. What a crowd we have here today. It's like a family reunion. You know what, it's for good purpose, because we have gathered here today to acknowledge the blessing of a beautiful woman in all of our lives. You see, a blessing because her times and influence continues today through the positive actions she would have done and the children of the Austin family in their various spheres of function. Thus, we've gathered together on this day to acknowledge a great woman. Some may have seen her as quiet and reserved, but deep down, she was a woman of steel. An on-time, dedicated superwoman, if you please. You know, Abraham Maslow posits that self-actualization is the achievement of one's full potential through creativity, independence, spontaneity, and a grasp for the real world. I believe that our beloved was at the top of the game, not only in terms of temporal needs being satisfied only, but also with an eternal hope and purpose in Jesus. But the reality is that even Superwoman has her kryptonite that can cause death. And we are gathered to celebrate the life of a great mother, wife, public servant, church member, and community builder, having battled with illness for a season. But even though we can no longer interact and speak to our beloved, all is not gloom and doom. For we have a great example of tenacity, a great example of making life through all the odds, a great example of maintaining faith in God and his promises, a great example of humility and respect for others, a great example of how to maintain a piece of the Garden of Eden on the Austin Reserve in Concordia, if you please, with a breathtaking view, I must add. You see, it's not all gloom and doom today, because the Bible reveals in Revelation chapter 14, verse 13, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them. You see, Mom has labored with distinction, and now she rests in Jesus, awaiting the second coming of Christ. Don't be cast down in this service today, because one of these days in Jesus, we'll all rise up and to walk in newness of life. Please stay with me for the next few moments as we consider the topic. We'll all rise up in spite of this. We'll all rise up in spite of this. Let's bow our heads, close our eyes. Father, Lord, even now, not my will, but thy will be done. Encourage your people today. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. We'll rise in spite of this, because as a song once said, there's no God like Jehovah. This sounds good to say, but it can be a cause of much confusion for some of us here today. You see, some teach that as a believer in Christ, we would not go through challenges and other situations that would severely test our faith. But brethren, is this true? Yes, we know that God can deliver the righteous out of temptation and reserve the ungodly until the day of judgment. But being Christian does not make us immune to the effects or consequences of sin or our inherited sick bodies. Whether we are religious or irreligious, we face challenges in this life, interpersonal issues, educational hiccups, socioeconomic barriers, inheritance issues, racism issues, religious understanding issues, gender identity issues, safety issues, improper socialization issues, simony and nepotism issues, personal morality issues, lack of finances or revenue, Joel, issues. And most of all, we are here today because we are facing a debt issue. You see, for some of you, you may feel as if this service is an indication of the fact that the enemy has won. Why is it
that even people of faith will get ill and at times even die from their illness? Why is it that sometimes we pray for healing and yet find ourselves planning a funeral? And even more so, why is it that sometimes we pray for things to get better in the various situations of our lives, but at times they get worse? If you feel confused and bewildered today, you are in the right place. Stay with me. We're going somewhere. You see, the Bible says in John chapter 10, verse 10, that the thief cometh not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy. You see, from the time of the Garden of Eden and the fall of mankind, the enemy continues to steal and to kill and to destroy, to steal our hope for the future, to kill our childhood dreams and aspirations, and to destroy the minds of many through addictions and other situations. And I can go on and on. But the Bible, ladies and gentlemen, continues that Jesus came to give us life and to give us more abundantly. You see, even though Genesis chapter 3 summarizes the circumstances surrounding the fall of mankind, it clarifies the purpose of divine love for mankind as well. Because Genesis chapter 3 verse 15, it says, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. I asked the doctors here today, I saw Dr. Inga Manswell Myrie earlier. I asked the question, which is more deadlier, a blow to the head or a blow to the heel? You see, the most the enemy could have done was affect the heel of Jesus. Because even though he orchestrated the crucifixion, in 3 days he rose again with power over death and the grave, power over principalities. But in the resurrection, Jesus would have died the death that sin needed and sin demanded so that we today can have life everlasting. In the resurrection, Jesus crushed the plan of the enemy to pull all of humanity into hell and ultimate destruction. He may have, and even today, the enemy, he may seem very forward, causing pain and suffering. But as old people say, I come. Because one of these days, not only his plans, but also his head literally will be crushed in Jesus' name. And God will restore order to his creation. Today we have hope. Hope in of everlasting life in Jesus. That's why we can repeat John 3:16 with confidence, for the Bible says what? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not what? Perish, but have everlasting life. You see, death, according to Ecclesiastes chapter 9 verse 5, is like an unconscious sleep, where the body and the life force from God becomes deconstituted. Are we together? Like powdered milk, minus the liquid. This is different from the perishing of John 3:16, which is the second death reserved for Satan and his angels and all those humans who decide to go on the side of the enemy. But according to Revelation chapter 20, even though our loved ones may be deconstituted, when the breath of life goes back to God and the body remains, one of these days, ladies and gentlemen, when Jesus returns, they'll be reconstituted. Not like any skim milk or low-fat milk, but like full cream in Jesus' name. Full cream to spend the ceaseless ages of eternity in the awesome presence of our Lord and Savior. And that's the hope of the believer, the hope that causes us to maintain our faith in Jesus in spite of the challenges that we face. The Apostle Paul clarifies this idea in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 17 and 18, where he says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more what? Exceeding an eternal weight of glory, why we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are what? temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. You see, we are not supposed to allow the situations that we face to cause us to change our minds in serving Jesus. In the midst of the storm, you can have peace when you know that your heavenly Father is the captain of your ship. Fuel your faith and continue to trust and hope in Jesus, and he promises us to soon return to turn things around. Don't give up on God, for he won't give up on you. Why? Because he's able. You see, the story of the prodigal son is a story of a father's love and acceptance for an erring child. As cited in Luke 15 from verse 11 and onwards, he was an upstart that decided to take his inheritance, which is usually distributed when the father dies, to have a nice time in a far country. In other words, he was looking at his dad and saying, I wished you were dead. Give me my money. After a while in the far country, there was a drought. His money ran out, and he ended up a vagrant. Rising up one day, he decided, you know what? I will go back to my father, because I'm sure he has some servants that are not living as rough as I am living. I will go back to him. I will ask him to take me as a servant, and I would serve him for the rest of my life. But when he went home, what he experienced was a father's love and forgiveness. What he experienced was a father's forgiveness and acceptance, because the father, he did not keep him or take him back as a servant, but as a son with full rights and privileges. You see, today we need to realize that the devil is a double dealer. He's a what? You see, the far country promise enjoyment and unrestrained pleasure, if you please. But the son did not realize that money, if not invested, after a while it runs out. And he did not anticipate the drought. You see, the enemy sets us up really high, and then he pulls out the foundation from beneath us, encouraging us in the wrong path, but at the end of the day, leaving us guilty and shame and turning his back on us. But you know, the real question that we need to ask today is, if you are a prodigal son or a prodigal daughter that may have slipped away from the gaze of our Heavenly Father, doing the things in the far country managed by the finances of the devil himself. You see, like the prodigal son today, you can rise up. Turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you can rise up. You can rise up in spite of what others think. You can rise up in spite of how you may feel. You can rise up in spite of where you might have been. You can rise up because the Father is still looking for you. He's what? He's still looking for you. The Father, our Father, our Heavenly Father, he has abundant love, second chances, and is more than able to keep you and to lead you back to the place that you need to be. You see, the Father's compassion in the story was evident in his acceptance of his son, in spite of the humiliation of the son returning as a vagrant. And it was uncustomary even back then for noblemen to run whilst in the street. But there, the father in the story, he was running to embrace his vagrant son in acceptance. You see, Jesus loves you today. And he's looking for you. He doesn't mind you coming back to him with your baggage. He's running towards you even today. You know, but in Jesus, our hope, ladies and gentlemen, is not just about our having our physical needs met. And this is the majority problem that I may have with the prosperity gospel. You see, God calls us to be his children, but not all Christians live in their own homes, drive a paid-off vehicle, and could wear a different outfit every day of the month. No. Some believers live in poverty, trusting in God for their next meal. But their hope and faith does not waver because they understand that the blessing of being a believer goes beyond this world. You see, as we read in our scripture reading in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 from verse 19, the Bible says, Paul says to us, if in this life only we have hope in Jesus, we have most men miserable, because some persons don't have things easy. Some persons have things bad, and you'll be miserable. But you see, guess what? But now Christ is risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that sleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all died, even so in Christ shall all be made alive, but every man in his own order. In his what? His own order. Christ the first fruits. Afterward, they that are Christ's at his coming. So even though you have been called out of this world, called to live like royalty, and you may have things hard in this world, one of these days when Jesus comes, we would live as kings and queens. We would live as prince and princesses. Why? Because our hope goes beyond the food, the clothing, and the shelter to the place where there'll be no more debt, no more sickness, no more sin, no more devil, no more grave. Our hope goes beyond the place where we would be able to reclaim the perfect sinless environment that Adam and Eve enjoyed before the fall of man. Our hope goes to the place where we'll see Jesus face to face and not through a glass dimly. Our hope goes to heaven at last. And I don't know about you, but I'm longing for heaven at last, because this world is getting worse. Things are getting harder. And the only thing that makes sense is my relationship with Jesus. Does that make sense to you today? That is the only thing that makes sense. But you see, the good thing is this. Jesus was the first fruit. You see, the first installment of a crop that foreshadowed the ultimate offering of the whole is what the first fruit is all about. And that's why Jesus is portrayed in Revelation as coming with a sharp sickle to reap the earth. Are we together? Because at the end of the day, on that day, the wheat and the tares, yes, we may grow together right now, but on that day, God will be coming to reap the wheat to take them to his eternal kingdom. And as in Adam all died, even in Christ we all shall be made alive. But ladies and gentlemen, we need to understand the made alive is in the future indicative passive tense, if you please. Thus, one of these days, definitely we shall be made alive. And we would have nothing on our side that would have made it possible. It would be all because of Jesus. We passively go through the experience. All we have to do is accept him, and he would lead us to that place that we need to be. That's why we understand that we are saved through grace, through faith, and not of works. And our salvation is the gift of God, acceptance of the Father. My admonishment to all of us today is that we get connected and stay connected to Jesus. Jesus also admonishes us in Matthew chapter 11 from verse 28. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall receive rest for your soul. For my yoke is what? Easy, and my burden is light. You see, the labor conveys the idea that we are weary and tired from hard work. And you see, back then, the demands of the Jewish teachers and the scribe was a burden to the people. You see, besides the Ten Commandments, they had over 400 other commandments that they wrote and that they had to adhere to. And it was burdensome. It did not make sense. But you know what is a good thing? The Bible says what? When we take the yoke of God, he will give us rest. He will give us rest. Not anybody else, but Jesus himself would give us rest. Not what the enemy gives. For the enemy gives us what? The wages of sin is what? Debt. So when we work for the enemy, we are working for a wage that we can't even spend. Because how can you spend debt, Brother Diamond? But you see, when you live for Jesus, he gives you a gift. And that gift, ladies and gentlemen, is what? Eternal life in Jesus' name. And that's why we are here, because the rest is the salvation for which they have striven without the oppression of and the weight of legalism. For by grace are ye saved through faith. Even Seventh-day Adventists at one time in the 90s coming up had an idea circulating that we're saved by works. But I'm thankful to God today that now the record is clear. There's only one way to heaven, and that's by accepting Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. There's only one way to make it, by having Jesus as your best friend. And when you have him as your best friend, we can celebrate a salvation by grace through faith that works in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. A salvation by grace through faith that works in Jesus' name. Take my yoke. The encouragement is that we take and hold on and connect with Jesus. I don't know what's your life circumstance today, but we are our best when we are closest to the man Christ Jesus. We are our best when we are closest to the man Christ Jesus. Take my yoke. It's not burdensome, but it's characterized by humility and concern for those who may be despised. Even Jesus, when he lived in his during his earthly ministry in Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, he declared, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he had anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He had sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." You see, the yoke, when we are yoked up with Jesus, we'll reach out to the poor. When we are yoked up, we'll reach out to the brokenhearted. We'll reach out to the captives. We'll reach out to those who may be bruised. And by the grace of God, it's all in preparation for the year of the Lord, like Jesus. You see, the yoke of Jesus is a yoke of change, a yoke of action, transformation, second chances, a yoke that empowers us to do exceeding abundant above all that you can ask, think, or desire, because it's not about your power, but God's power working through you. A work that is not only a blessing in this time, informing your choices and your actions, but a yoke that gives confidence eternally. A yoke of freedom in Jesus to regain the perfection that was taken from Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden through trickery from the enemy. A yoke that enables us free passage back to our Heavenly Father. That's why John the Revelator says in Revelation chapter 22, verse 17, "And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. Oh, taste, I say today, and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the person that trusteth in the Lord. Oh, taste for yourself and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord." As we wrap up today, I came to remind you that God works in mysterious ways. For some of you, it's this funeral that would have caused you to hear the gospel that can make a new and improve you in this moment and for the future. Thus, I encourage all of us to trust in the leadings of the Lord. Don't compromise what we know to be right. Trust in God to always work things out. Not when you want him to, but at the right time, God's time. Don't allow family members, don't allow your present challenges or even this debt to cause you to lose faith. To the contrary, see it as an opportunity for all of us to have a similar faith and tenacity like our sister Austin. In our country today, on our island, many things may be down. Community spirit is what? Down. Brotherly love, down. Safety, down. And even sometimes the fast ferry, down. But in Jesus, as bad as things may be, we have hope that we'll rise up. And not just rise up, but rise up in spite of the challenges we face. For 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 and 17, it says, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ, like Sister Austin, shall what? Rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet them together in the clouds, and thus we shall ever be with the Lord." I don't know about you, but we have this hope that burns within our heart, hope in the coming of the Lord. We have faith in Jesus, knowing that one of these days we'll rise up to meet with him and to walk in newness of life. We have comfort even in this time, for we serve a high priest who is touched with the feeling of our infirmities, and he knows that he will be there, family members, to help you navigate through this grief experience so that we can all end well in Jesus. We have hope in the fact that weeping may endure for the night, but joy cometh in the morning. We have hope because we've exercised our faith in an omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient, omnibenevolent God who wishes that none should perish, but that all should come to repentance. We have hope even today. Don't be cast down. Look to Jesus and we'll rise up. We'll rise like the day. We'll rise up. We'll rise unafraid. We'll rise up. Why? For in Jesus, we always win. Rise up in Jesus' name. One of these days, we'll have no more cancer. Rise up in Jesus' name. One of these days, we'll have no more sickness and death. Rise up in Jesus' name. One of these days, we'll have no more sin. Let's rise up in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
TCA 3021, please attend to your vehicle now. Thank you, Pastor Altley, for that word that will rise up in Jesus' name. At this time, we'd like to say a prayer of comfort for the family. So if the family members can come closer to the front around the casket, that we will lift them up to Jesus Christ. Knowing that in times like these, the best friend to have is Jesus. When the storms of life upon you roll, he will heal your wounded heart. He will strength and grace impart. The best friend to have is Jesus. I commend you to Jesus. He will take you through the future and land you safely on the heavenly shore. Let's press as close. Yet, and you promise a joyful resurrection morning. We are thankful for the messages that you shared with us today. In a special way, Lord, we are thankful for the gift in the life of Sister Marilyn Austin. We are thankful for all that you have done in her and through her. We are thankful for the contribution she has made to our lives, to our homes, and to our community. We are thankful for the life that she has touched and the legacy that she has left for us. At this time, Lord, I want to ask a special blessing rest on the family. Comfort them, Lord, in this hour of grief. Remind them that death is not the end and you have victory over death. Help them, Lord, to position themselves for greatness. And remind them that greatness is found in Jesus Christ. Help them to stay at the feet of Jesus so that they could be taught by him. Help them to stay in the hand of Jesus Christ so that they could be protected by him. Help them to stay in the arms of Jesus so they can be comforted by him. Help them, Lord, to rest on the shoulder of Jesus that they can find support in going through difficult times.
Help them, Lord, to stay at the side of Jesus, that they could find fellowship when they feel lonely. And help them always to stay in the presence of Jesus where they can be refreshed. Thank you, Lord, for the blessing that you're going to pour upon them. Prepare them, Lord, so that when time shall change into eternity and they are found faithful, they can see their loved one again and be reunited, never to part again, but to exchange for eternity the good and the blessed that come from Jesus Christ. We thank you for hearing and answering our prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Please take your seats.
HDC 7503. I'm kind of tired of doing this, but where are you going to go? HDC 7503. Please remove your vehicle. When the roll is called up yonder, we will be there. Oh, yes. We are glad to have with us Brother Joe. That's how we call him, Brother Joe. House of Assembly man, and he's going to do acknowledgement for us, and then we will sing.
Good morning. Thank you so much for the correction. Good afternoon. It's indeed a good afternoon as we celebrate the life and the homegoing of my dear mother. Please permit me at this time to recognize the Honorable Kelvin Charles, Chief Secretary of the Tobago House of Assembly, Presiding Officer Dr. Denise Soyofat Angus, all my assembly colleagues, thank you for coming out in your numbers. Please also permit me to recognize in their absence our two MPs, Honorable Shamfoka Joe and Mrs. Ayanna Webster Roy. They were here earlier. Also, please permit me to recognize Her Honor Justice Janice Nichols. And also I want to recognize Dr. Austin, Brian, all my aunts, uncles, cousins, dear friends, my guru, Ms. Lejean, Mr. Pierre, and so many others, Dr. Bishop, so many others. Your presence here this morning symbolizes the impact that my mother had on a lot of persons. And I want to thank everyone for coming out this morning, you know, from near and far. You know, our relatives came in from abroad, but we also had a couple friends and well-wishers who came as far as Trinidad, you know, to support and celebrate the life of Marilyn, Grace, Jerry, Jack, Austin. And please forgive me if I forget anyone at this time, but there's a song sung by Michael Jackson, which has gone too soon. Like a comet blazing across the evening sky, gone too soon. Like a rainbow, like a rainbow fading in the twinkling of an eye, gone too soon. Shiny and sparkling and splendidly bright, here one day and gone one night. I always tell person I'm a mama's boy, and I make no apologies about that. She was a gem, a wonderful mother. '66, just as she was beginning to living, enjoying her grandchildren, gone too soon. Ecclesiastes says there is a time and there is a season. Season of death. I'm glad that I had the work so that I wouldn't be breaking down day by day. You know, I remember leaving to go to St. George's in 99. And we have something that we do with my mama. I would be hugging her and kissing her and tickling her. And she would say, boy, leave me alone, leave me alone. Rubbing her head, always kissing her. And she would be saying, leave me alone. And I remember in 99, I said, one day I'll be leaving her for a little while. And she would laugh. When I told her I was going to university to study, because she was always urging me, what about your studies? You're not going and do your first degree? You're not going and do your master's? She was my number one cheerleader. When I left to go to St. George's, she cried. She broke down and cried. I remember at the wedding, the pastor was saying, well, you have to leave and cleave. And my mother was saying, you'll have to cleave a little. Because I was a mother's boy. Every time I pay her a visit, what always kept me grounded, in addition to her words and her love and her support, would have been that wall of achievement that she would keep. Every time I appeared in the papers, she would cut out a clipping and stick it on a wall. And I always say, I can't disappoint my mother. I can't disappoint my mother. In the midst of all my challenges, she was right there with me. And this is why we need an extra effort to have a lot of flowers around, because if you know Marilyn Grace Austin, she was always in the midst of her plans, in the midst of everything. I want to thank you all for coming out. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, the rest of the team. To my people who have had the privilege to serve for Monks in George. You know, you were there with me in the midst of it. The village, back at Monks St. George, the village council, everybody. I want to thank Mr. Kalinda and the party and the Women's League for your show of support and your love. I want to thank the SDA family for reaching out to us. I want to thank also the Moravian family, whom I'm at a part, in a short stint serving. And as we leave today and we celebrate her life, she has left us with an indelible mark, an example. Her passion, her commitment to work, her commitment to family, her commitment to to God is indeed an example for all of us to emulate and for all of us to follow. I just want to thank my aunt, Auntie Cecile, and Auntie Betty. You know, I left a meeting last Monday, a budget consultation meeting last week Monday, and we were supposed to meet with a team from oncology to plan the way forward for how we would take care of Mom. And I'm so happy I left that meeting. But those were the final 2 hours, the two precious hours. I just had a sense of urgency that I had to keep a commitment to meet a dignitary on the airport. And I had a sense of urgency to leave. And I left, and by the time I got to the airport, Kamari was saying, you know, he's saying that Mom has stopped breathing and to come back. And I said, Mom will be fine. And sometimes the ways of God, we can't understand. We just have to trust Him. Trust Him. And I trust God in the midst of this, that she's no longer in pain. You know, and I want to thank as well Dr. Alfred and Dr. Bishop. They were there with us. And you know, doctor, they gave me the prognosis, and that shattered me, because this was a third battle with this affliction, and I was ready to fight. I would move mountains. To ensure that she was restored to health. But I trust God. God knows best. No pain, no sickness, nothing else. But I know I am comforted that she's in the arms of the Lord. And while I was reading the budget statement, I was tempted to just break down. But I just saw her smile and remember. Saw that smiling face encouraging me to go on. Come on, you can make it. And this is the impact as a parent that, you know, you need to have on your child. And I want to thank, you know, the team from finance, administrator, the rest of the staff who continue to work with me as a team, that we can achieve so much for this island. God bless you richly. I know my mom would have been proud that you came to celebrate her life and her legacy. She's gone, but she will never be forgotten. Thank you, and God bless you all.
Lift him up one more time in a good round of applause. Amen. Thank you, Brother Joe. Thank you. As far as I know, as Mom 1, and that is Mom 2. Am I right, Brother Joe? Praise God. She's still there for you. God is good, and He will always be good. We want to wrap up the morning. The plan with me was for 1 o'clock, but we run over a little bit. That's all right. We have enough time to get to the graveside and to do what we have to do over there. So we want to stand up and we want to sing. Everybody knows the song, "When the Roll is Called Up Yonder, I'll Be There." And okay. All right. So let's rise and and we will pray, and then we'll sing. So while we are singing, we're going to move the casket to the front, and we are going to open here for the last time. When we close here, we will not be open again. So everybody, those who came late and so on, will have a chance to have the last look. We want to encourage the congregation to go first, and we will leave the family for last so they can have their final take your time look. Not a rush. The family will come last, right? So while we are singing, we will roll the casket out to the front, and we will wait for you to file out on both sides, and then we are going to ask the family to come over last. We had a nice message. What do you say? Amen. It's a good sermon. And for those of you who know, seeing that we are talking about retired government folks, everybody know Sister Purvis Utley? You know that name? It's her son. Amen? It's her son. Amen. When the roll is called, let's pray. We're going to pray, sing, and then begin to move. Father, thank you. Praise your name. You have been good. You will always be good. Take us now and fix us according to your divine plan. Bless the family for one more time. Yeah. And keep them mindful that Jesus is soon to come and he's mighty to save.
Amen.
Please accept our short prayer. Even now we pray. Take care of us on the road as we go. The police escort. May we do well on the road and do well until we see Jesus. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Let's sing. Let's sing.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the saints of God shall gather over on the other shore, and the road is gone up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, when the road is gone up yonder, when the road is gone up yonder, when the road is gone up yonder, when the road is gone up yonder,
on that bright and cloudless morning,
on that bright and cloudless morning, and the glory of his resurrection shall,
when the chosen
one shall gather to the home beyond the sky, and the rolling star up yonder I'll be there. Oh, when the
place of interment is at the Bacalet Cemetery.
When peace like a river.
Yes, I don't sing it. The place of interment is at the Bacalet Cemetery. And the Reapers, John Dial Community Center. The Reapers will be at the John Dial Community Center. So we're going to sing And Can It Be as we wrap it up.
My prayer.